you all. Yeah, I'm also honored for these lasting 7 minutes I have, because we have still already 15 minutes of delay. But I prefer to shorten my talk significantly, as we have these minutes, the maintenance time. We have in these minutes maintenance time, which lasts till 12. Of course, we have the DC before, so I'd like to exploit it properly. This is the place where you are. We will visit, so I'm going, first of all, to illustrate the visit, together with the others. There are four locations: auditorium, the place where we are now, control room, a central building named Adalberto Giazzotto, and possibly back on pipe to have a look at the 400 meter section of the park. This was built because the main hardware was there, and then we migrated to other buildings, and the things, of course, became larger. Nowadays, Virgo is a rather large collaboration, maybe about 400 members over 8 countries. Several countries were added much later. At the beginning it was 50-50 Italy and France. We joined the observational run number 2, so-called O2, which was very successful for us. Indeed, as you know, gravitational waves have been already observed directly by the LIGO-Virgo collaboration together, which used to operate as a single machine on the data 1 year before, 1.5 year before. But the great observational run O2 was significantly impacting on this science, because there were triple observations of gravitational waves by black hole collapses, and some binary black hole collapses, where a new astrophysics was born. Now, in these days, we are performing O3, which is 1 year long observational run, which is supposed to last till May 2020. And many observations are expected, at least, could be probably published. This is what I'm allowed to say. This is nowadays the network. Virgo is a part of a network. A network is made not by two, but at least by three. So in the future, we have more, a panorama of more installations for the world, especially Kagra, which is starting this year, and it will probably join the O3 run at the end. And also India, with a longer lasting panorama, but joining LIGO, of course, it will explore LIGO technology. This is a tribute to Einstein. I'm not going through these equations, but they are so beautiful, so they deserve a mention here, because there is a geometry on the left side, which is what causes what we call gravity, and on the right, there is energy impulse tensor, which causes the energy. The two things essentially are connected by the only sign which is important in equation, which is the signal of equal. So the two things are related to each other, but we are not talking anymore about gravity. We are talking about curvature, which is what really is beyond it. And the essential point is that through this linearization of the equations, we end up, in absence of sources, to the standard equation of waves as known by this very important paper by Albert Einstein. And we are observing the waves not in such a regime on the left, but in such a ring on the right, which is as a small wrinkle on a Lorentz background. So this is where we are located now, and we are trying to derive from these wrinkles which was the situation at the source, here on the left. And so this is the second very important. You are all physicists, so you know, but gravitational waves are transversal waves, a wave vector which is on the Earth axis here, and they are transversal and deployed over two polarization direction. And the tidal deformation of the matrix is indicated by these oscillations. Energies are very small due to this very small factor we have. This is an homologous of Larmor's formula. This is shown for the students usually, sorry. But I have to mention the acceleration of quadrupole mass provides the emission, the luminosity of the source, but it's attenuated by such a very small factor of quantity. It's so small that we have, in case of a supernova in the nearby or in the galaxy, such a very small strain at the Earth. 10^-21. And this is what ends. I have no more formulas, but the content is there. What is astonishing still even to me is that the same kind of device which was used by Einstein in the context of building up special relativity, which is the evidence provided by the Michelson interferometer, is nowadays used for detecting gravitational waves, which was one of the three main predictions provided by the general theory of relativity. So this is apparently this is an optimal device to detect gravitational waves, imaging waves coming perpendicular to the plane. They provide such a deformation. They are fringes formed here at the optical port where the two beams coming reflected by the end masses, test masses, let me call them test masses, are recombined. And at the output we have fringes. You have heard of resonant bars detecting gravitational waves. Once, this is for the history, for you, once gravitational waves were supposed to be detected by interferometers, of course, this kind of resonant detectors which had a very very short small bandwidth of detection passed away. Let me say they went to the museum because the bandwidth and then the number of sources which could be detected by means of these wideband detectors were much clearly. One important point this kind of detector, we're going to the experimental phase, is that they are not properly electromagnetic, they do not resemble in any way the electromagnetic telescopes, as telescopes used to detect photons. In this case, once we have a deformation of the wave, which is optimally coupled here with the Hartzog interferometer and provides such a deformation here in the yellow box, we have an amplitude at the output which is essentially proportional to the power, to the amplitude of the wave. So this is the power on the photodiode. It is proportional to the leakage of leakage of light coming here is proportional to the amplitude of the wave. This is very important because since these waves fade as 1/r, the distance, it means essentially, and not like 1/r² the distance, it means essentially that any improvement in the detectable distance implies a volume of sources to be detected which is much larger. So if I have a sensitivity which is 10 times larger it means that my the volume I embrace is 1,000 times larger. So this is an essential point that drives us to upgrade our interferometers so frequently instead of waiting for a long time. As we it's a continuous run trying to improve the technologies, because any small improvement of sensitivity implies a number of sources. This is again about the kind of detection we do. With one interferometer we have some blind directions which must be delineated here, you see. Of course, they are related to the given polarization which is considered. So in the middle, at 45 degrees on the plane of the arms, the detector is blind. But we have more detectors, and moreover, we have two polarizations. So all these things are considered. And this is how you are physicists, so you have studied all these things very nicely. So this is for the student, but we will go indeed to illustrate a much more complicated device, which is not merely this one. What I want to depict here is the fact you see how at the port, at the end of the interferometer, at the detection port, once we have the wave which makes a differential variation of the length, we have combination of constructive and destructive interference. So we have the signal. So this is the ideal detector. An important thing which must be illustrated here is what we see, what we call sensitivity of the device. Sensitivity is essentially the noise limitation to the detection. It means that in this case here, for instance, I cannot detect a signal which is smaller at 20 Hertz than given the sensitivity by the blue here, maybe 10 to minus 22, which is indeed a very small number. This is the present sensitivity. The purple is the sensitivity of roughly 2 years ago. We detected gravitational waves with this detector once we had the purple sensitivity. So you can imagine this. The kind of sources we can detect nowadays is a bit significantly larger at this frequency here. Normally, this is the range of massive black holes or this kind of sources. And another point is we measure normally in strain units per square root of Hertz, which is the linear spectral density of the strain. This is a unit which is normally not so common, but it's usual for measuring the noise. The claim of Virgo was that Virgo had to be designed as a detector limited only by intrinsic noise. This is the main point of Virgo. Since the beginnings, thanks to the idea of Alberto Giazzotto, who designed a system which could allow to detect, for instance, to settle in operation an interferometer in a place where the ground motion was 10 to a times larger than what we had to detect. So we needed an attenuation system properly designed. Of course, there are thermal vibration of the test masses. Any mass, thanks to Brownian studies, we know that vibrates just by the fact that it is at a given temperature and it has a given dimension, a given extension. So that's a limit, several limits. We have to beat all these limits, but most we will be impressed by looking at these devices. This is typical of Virgo, this is why I spent one word more on this. The seismic isolation system is something quite sophisticated. It's a series cascade of pendula and of springs. As you see, the transfer function of a single pendulum hardly allows to have 100 times attenuation at few hertz. This is what we would like to have. Why? Because we should have a pendulum which is at least 25 meters long. to have with just one stage, but we can add two stages, and then we reach the point. If we can add more stages, as we did in Virgo, we can have maybe 240-280 dBs at 10 Hz, which means 10 to the minus 14. We have also inverted pendulum, which is a kind of metronome, so you can this is the transfer function of the inverted pendulum, very, very slow motion. You can imagine the equivalent length of a pendulum is 280 meters. So it's the equivalent of a pendulum, very tall. And we have also this. We have a series of an inverted pendulum and a cascade pendulum. And there is something which cannot be shielded. It's intriguing to be mentioned. I think it deserves a mention here, which is the fluctuation of the small g direction of gravity, which is actually affected by the seism moves the mass around the interferometer, and hence we have a direct action on the mass that cannot be shielded. So next studies concerning evolution of these kind of detectors will be the subtraction of this noise from the overall sensitivity. This can be only subtracted, measured elsewhere by means of network sensors, and then subtracted. This is just a gallery, and then we close. Thanks to the fisheye, you can see in a small spot the 3 kilometer long arms, and Virgo is deployed along these strips. Okay, this is north arm going towards the hills, and this goes towards the sea. And this is, we will see this, the pipe. Some amusement, Topolino published about gravitational waves, and before, if I properly remember, just when they had been detected. These are the test masses, which are located at the bottom of the attenuation chain. We will discuss and revisit. Some very high level technologies published elsewhere. The world is plenty of these things nowadays. This is a picture of the suspension. I will illustrate this directly. We see these elements, very highly performing optics. All the optics is suspended. You see, this is shown because I wanted to show you these three stuff here, three wires. They suspend such a complex optical bench. Everything is suspended in Virgo to avoid vibrations. This is the test mass. It's a 42 kilograms weight test mass. You see pink because generally there is a kind of layer to protect the coating. This is the overall, the payload. And the mirrors are usually suspended through thin fiber wires. Very impressive, because they are very robust. This test mass, it's a dummy test mass, in this moment, during test, is suspended through 200 micrometer diameter glass fibers. They are very resistant and elastic. Of course, we have to test them in advance. I always enjoy it. And let me conclude, of course this is very well known by all of us. I want just to pick up something. You can sleep, and before going to sleep, think that these two masses going one on the other, inspiring black holes, the first event, they are reaching each other at half speed of the light. They are very heavy bodies. 30 solar masses going so fast. This is very impressive, indeed. And you can imagine the sky, which is illuminated by three gravitational wave radiation of three solar masses in 0.5 seconds, in less than half a second, which is larger than the overall luminosity of the visible. You can imagine the natural explanation of plastic. This is O2, our discoveries give rise to this observation, triangle observation of the binary black hole system, which really, this is important for you, opened the way towards multi-messenger astrophysics, because this is not just geometry, like black holes, which it's more intriguing to me, but that is only geometry. In this case, this is real astrophysics, because you mix the gravitational waves observation with the matter we have in our life. And let me conclude with just with a tribute to Adalberto. This is a picture taken by a technician, which signifies essentially how this person was a scientist and a man so important for all of us. So he's always present in our life. And concluded, thank you.